Gamburd here to talk to us about arithmetic.
Thank you very much. It's, so, I'm a little trailer. So it's a pleasure to be here and an honor to give a mathematics colloquium. This is the first time. And it's a Stony group that I work. I'm going to talk about is joint with power. So there are two papers, one series of papers and another paper which I would like to discuss. The focus would be on the joint work with Bourgain and Sarnak.
Would you write larger?
Larger, yes. I'll take off my jacket and then I'll shall I speak louder also?
This is fine.
Okay, I'll write larger. Okay. And I can use all of them. All of them. Okay, so then this is a series of papers called Markoff-Hurwitz and Stony approximation. And then there is joint work with which is entitled an asymptotic formula for integer points on Markoff-Hurwitz surfaces. And they are from the archive. So yeah, this is the in more detail. But the focus will be on the Markov surfaces. So I will say a few words about modulation and history in a moment. Let me begin by defining the main object of study. So this is an equation which appeared in the thesis of Markov. This is this is Andrei Andreevich Markov, the Markov chain's fate, the L. And I'm always tempted to explain what he did, because it's a really deep and beautiful result. What time do I have to end? Depending on when I have to end, I might resist that temptation or not. So, 5.
We start at 8, so you can go 5 past 5.
5 past 5.
Yeah.
Thank you. So this. Okay, let me define the equation. So it's a very simple equation. X1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared is equal to 3x1, x2, x3. This is a Markov equation. Markov triples. The positive integer solution. Markov numbers. So Markov numbers. How many people have seen Markov numbers or came across Markov? How many people have heard of Markov chains? So the same guy. Yeah. And this is actually his depot work, I claim. So, okay, so I'll tell you what he drew in a moment. Markov numbers. It's just a coordinate. Do I have to write so big? I think you. And then there is a notion, that there is a subtle distinction between these two. I will not go on. There is a notion of a Markov sequence, which is the largest coordinate of a Markov triple, counted with multiplicity. Okay, so let me tell you how this equation arose in his work, maybe very briefly. Let me tell you the first. So Markov proved infinitely many theorems. I'll tell you the first two. So the first theorem is usually attributed to Hurwitz, who gave a beautiful self-contained proof, but it's already in Markov's work. So this is the following. So if you have an irrational number, then it admits infinitely many rational approximations P over Q, such that alpha minus P over Q is less than 1 divided by square root of 5 Q squared. This is an easy part. This is sharp for alpha, which is G of to Z equivalent, to take a 1, which is a golden ratio. This is the first result. Second result was proved by Markov's doctoral advisors, Korkin and Zolotar. So it says in, so I looked on the Wikipedia, it says that Chebyshev was Markov's advisor. That is not correct. He was on his committee. But the dissertation was supervised by Korkin and Zolotar. Zolotar died in 1878. He was taking a train from St. Petersburg and he got on the train. And then when the train started again, somehow he fell, and 12 days later he died in the hospital. But before that, he sent a letter to Korkin, which you can find in his collected work, where the proof of this result is contained. And they formulated this result in terms of minimal binary quadratic forms, but I'm formulating it. It's an equivalent formulation. So if alpha is not GL to Z equivalent to theta 1, then it admits infinitely many rational approximations P over Q, such that alpha minus P over Q is less than 1 over square root of A Q squared, and this is sharp if alpha is 0 to Z equivalent to theta 2 equal to 1 plus square root of 2. Now Markov proves an infinite sequence of these theorems. So with each Markov number, let me maybe just try the formula. So I'm going to get the sequence of Markov numbers in a moment, but with each Markov number, that will have an equality which, the first two of which I've written down, and the general form of the inequality is as follows. Okay. So, I'm not going to do justice to Markov's work and what led to it. There is a paper I would recommend, there's enough. There's a paper by Bombieri called The Markov Tree. And he did the complete proof of Markov's result using continued fractions. Markov himself, well, it's complex because he started with continued fractions and he switched to binary quadratic forms. Let me draw the Markov tree. Maybe before doing that, at least I will say something about this result. Okay. Before drawing the tree, and then I'll draw the tree because I have a feeling that I will not really get to discuss the paper with McGee and Ron unless I do it right now. So following the publication, the first reference to Markov's work I found is a paper by Hurwitz in 1907, where he looks at the generalization of the Markov equation. He put something here. He says, I want to find the integers such that when you sum, I want to find n tuples of integers such that when you add their squares, they're divisible by their product. That's the equation. And then at some point he gets to n equals 3 case and says actually her map, disappears in Markov's work. So the solutions of this is a Markov-Hurwitz equation that I'm talking about here. Then in 1913, Frobenius wrote a paper called the Uberti Markov Shenzhen. That's why I think the spelling is Markov here. Frobenius. And Frobenius is. He says this is a extremely deep. I mean, he uses very strong language to describe this result. It's a very deep result. I think Frobenius was not easily impressed. So I think at some point he wrote a letter, a recommendation for David Hilbert, where he said that this guy is pretty good, but he will never be as good as Schottky. Anyway, he's very impressed with Markov, and he is. There are many things happening in this paper, but he makes a conjecture which is still open, which is uniqueness conjecture, asserting that M is equal to MS in this. So that is not going to be important for what follows. It's easier to proceed for a single soon. Okay, and then the next thing that I want to mention is the result of that here. Which says that these numbers are very sparse. So, there is a paper of Zagier in 1982 where he. There was a proof given earlier by Gamburd. Yeah, let me actually get this history straight. So, the result I'm about to state was proved earlier in the thesis of Gamburd and published thesis in 1976. So he proved this result by comparing Markov tree with Fire tree. Zagier proves his result by comparing Markov tree with Euclid tree. The result is that when you count Markov numbers up to t, they grow like c log t squared. So nth Markov number grows like a to the square root of n. Now, a much sharper error term was subsequently obtained by Mirzakhani and by McShane and Reedon. And there is a very beautiful proof of this result in the last paper of Bellis. What we prove in this paper is, okay, so this counts the number of points on this variety. So what this counts the number of points in this variety when you intersect it with a ball of size t. Okay? Now when you look at this variety, you can add k, but let me just for simplicity. Okay. So what we prove here is that when you count the number of points, let me call this Vn. So when you count the number of points on this variety, and intersect it with a ball of size t, right, it grows like log t to the power beta n, which is not in general integral, but most likely transcendental. And the reason, okay, and the reason for complication is that, so we proceed in a way which is similar to the proof of Zagier, but when you get to Euclid tree in high dimensions, what we have to look at is a generalized continued fraction algorithm in high dimensions. Instead of standard Gauss map, which is sort of implicitly appearing here, you are dealing with invariant measure associated with a set of transformations whose limit set has fractional Hausdorff damage. And I think that's all I might be able to say about this paper. They both, okay, so these numbers are sparse. They have Markov numbers, have this very deep relation to diophantine approximation. There's another paper, which is a very nice paper where this is presented. There is a paper by Castles called the Markov chain, the Markov. So in fact, the term Markov chain appears for the first time in the paper by Frobenius, Markov Schoenkatten. What I'm about to describe now. So let me tell you what Markov tree is. So this one will not need any more of the erasing. So there is one solution of this equation which is staring you in the face, and that is 1-1-1. Okay? And then, if you, okay. Then if you view this equation as a quadratic equation in x1, you see that the two solutions are related as follows. So this is equal to 3x2 x3. So if you have one solution, you can obtain another solution by applying what is called the Vieta involution, given by 3x2 x3 minus x1 x2 x3. And the group generated by these involutions is, when applied to the root solution, so there is, now let me leave this for a moment. So there is a root solution, and the set of the Markov triple can be viewed as an orbit under the action of gamma acting on R. So there is this root solution, and then you get a tree. So at the beginning there is a one, two, one, two, five.
This question is still
open, although the numerical evidence that was obtained already in 2005 is very convincing that they are. So after working for a while on this problem and making no progress, what we did was to look at a similar question in the setting where the group, where the sequence that you get is sparse, but that group, although what is now called thin, is acting linearly. The key difficulty here is that direction is not linear. So I think it is very instructive to very quickly take a look at the situation, which is in many ways parallel to the Markov case, and where by now we have basically complete understanding of the question. So the first question that we are asking, okay, so the question that we started thinking about 10 years, more than 10, probably, was whether these graphs, Markov graphs, form a family of expanders. And I'm just going to very briefly describe the parallel situations where this question and more difficult ones are now completely understood, and I will indicate what is the source of difficulty here. That is a situation pertaining to the integral Apollonian packets. And the equation that is relevant here is the Descartes equation. So let me write the Descartes equation. Any questions?
So what are the expanders?
So these are highly connected sparse graphs. So but I can very quickly give the definition. So so intuitively these are highly connected sparse graphs. The easiest way to measure connectivity is as follows. So given a graph. So a graph consists of vertices and edges. Given a subset of the vertices, you can find the expansion of a subset to be the ratio of the set of neighbors to the size of the subset. So these are edges between B and B component. And then the expansion of a graph is given as a minimum of the expansion coefficients, just a minute, of size of most one half. So this is another professor perpetual constant. Okay, of course, if you have n vertices and you connect all of them, it will be very highly connected, but it will not be sparse. So what you want is that the number of edges grows linearly with the number of vertices. And the easiest way to have this happen is to demand that the graph is k-regular. Like this, if when you project this mod p, you get a three-regular graph. So the definition here, so g sub n k is a family of k-regular graphs, forms a family, forms a family of expanders if there is a positive family value C such that the expansion coefficient for all the graphs in the family is greater or equal to C. This is it. Now this is a notion which is intuitively very easy to grasp, but it's defined as a minimum over all subsets of size at most a half, so it grows exponentially with a number of vertices. So what gets the subject started in some sense is that this has an equivalent spectral interpretation as follows. So associated with the graph, we have an adjacency matrix. If I is essentially equal to 1, if I j is an edge and 0 otherwise. So it's an n by n matrix with largest eigenvalue equal to k, corresponding to the constant eigenvector. And note that lambda 0 is going to be strictly greater than lambda 1 if and only if the graph is connected. And in fact, it turns out that there is a very close relation between the spectral gap between k and lambda 1. So this condition can be formulated equivalently as demanding that lambda 1 of the adjacency matrix be strictly less than some kappa less than k. Or to put it in the language of the Laplacian, so this is ki minus a, one can also ask for the first positive eigenvalue of the Laplacian to be greater or equal than mu greater than 0. Okay. Now, let me just say that the first familiar expanders in some sense goes back to the... So, it's a story. Expanders... but there is a celebrated result of Silver, which... so S of P is H 1 gamma P. Gamma P is the matrix is congruent to 1 1 P. This is a theorem of Silver in 1965. And from this you get expanders as scalar graphs of S of P with respect to generators of S of Z. What I did in my thesis in 1999 was to generalize it to infinite index subgroup whose slope is kind of out of dimension. So there you get similar situation, and that is why when Lindis and Rekatesh asked Peter Sarnak this question, I learned about it also. So, going back to... let me just very quickly... So, this is what we're asking. We're asking whether the graphs that you get here when you reject motif are highly connected. And what we just proved is that they are connected. And that's what strong approximation...
that's what would be the consequences, so why...
What would be the consequence of them being expanders? Okay, so to be honest, even after we prove that they're expanders, that would not be sufficient to say, to prove that there are infinitely many square free Markov numbers, because the sequence is way too sparse. But let me tell you the consequence of them being connected. So let me state theorem 3. So what the consequence of them being connected, so we cannot answer this question about whether there are infinitely many square field Markov numbers. And even if we prove that they're expanders, there's another ingredient that, well, let me tell you a consequence of them being connected, which is the following. So the consequence of them being connected is that let me just say it. So this is theorem 3. And it says that almost all Markov numbers are composite. When you first hear it, it doesn't sound very impressive. Almost all numbers are composite. But even that takes a bit of a proof. This was the second result that Euler proved after proving that there are infinitely many primes. So this shows that there are not too many primes. And if you look at the sparse sequences, if you look at the sequence, okay, so if you look at the sequence, yes, you can call these CUNY numbers. It is not known whether this statement is true for this sequence. So even assuming generalized Riemann hypothesis, which allowed Hulley to give a conditional proof of Artin's conjecture, it is not known. He had to make an additional he had to make an additional hypothesis, which I will not have time to go into. So, so the problem that we are dealing with here is in the level of difficulty intermediate between this much harder case of Artin's conjecture and much simpler case, which I want to very briefly describe, and that is of Apollonius or Plutarchus, where we by now have a complete understanding of so we know that the graphs which arise in the case of Apollonian circumpolars are expanders, and as a consequence, we can prove in that. So Apollonian circle packing case is somewhat special in the class of spin groups it's so for Apollonian circle packings, we can prove much more than we can prove in general. But in general, in the case of in the context of thin linear groups, once you prove expansion, what you can establish is that this sequence of numbers would have infinitely many almost primes. So not just square field numbers, but it would have infinitely many numbers which are products of, say, nine primes. That is an arithmetic consequence of expansion in the thin linear set. So the equation of Descartes is very, very close. Equation 4. This, there is an old result of Apollonius of Perga, which is that if you have three mutually tangent circles, and exactly two other circles which are tangent to this three. So if I denote the curvatures by A2, A3, A4, A1, and this is A1. And again, I view this equation as a quadratic equation in X1. I have that X1 plus X1 prime is equal to 2x2 plus 2x3 plus 2x4. But the transformation that you obtain is a linear one. So this is, in fact, this is this Vieta involution in this case is interchanging the blue and the red circle. This is A1. And so if you start with a configuration of circles whose curvatures are integral, and then you repeatedly fill in the rooms, you obtain, so I start with A1, A2, A3, A4. And I start with this initial configuration. Then the Apollonian group on A gives me the set of all the quadruples associated with this initial configuration is obtained in the same way. Lambda acting on A. Okay. Now, one thing that I should point out, if you count the number of elements in the group such that the norm of this is less than t, this grows like t to the delta, where delta is a half of the dimension of the limit set. So if you go one dimension lower, you get t to the delta with delta arbitrarily close to zero. So the sequence is quite sparse, but not nearly as sparse as this one. But what is really making this problem simpler is that the action is linear. So here we now have, so this is what is called a fine linear scheme. So here we have a complete understanding that so the congruence graphs are expanders, and as a consequence, now one thing I should say straight away that I'm talking about expansion for prime moduli. To get applications in the fine linear sieve, you need expansion for square free moduli. But here we now have expansion for all moduli. This series is complete, basically. Here the situation is much harder than this thin linear case, but simpler than the case of Martin's conjecture. So let me tell you what we can. So I have 15 minutes. Okay. And you didn't know what I was going to talk about, so you can read the paper. I mean, I got distracted, but if you're interested, you can read the paper. I'll state the results. Probably will not have time to get too much into the proofs. Let's see what I can do. So I define the Markov graphs here. And started looking at this in 2000. Hi, the progress that you made very recently. Let me just talk. Okay, so I defined this. I defined Markov graphs in formulae. Let me define the formulae and then state the basic conjectures and results. So Markov graphs define. So the vertices are the elements of this variety reduced mod pi without the point 0, 0, 0, and you connect x to R1, x, R2, x, R3 of x. So there are two So again, for k greater than or equal to 3, they are expanders. If SLPP is strongly uniformly expanded, and this was proved by Breuillard and myself. So SLPP, we proved, is strongly uniformly expanding for, this is true for infinitely many primes of density 1. Now, for k equals 2, the situation is very different. You cannot possibly have connectivity of the product replacement graph because of the freak identity. So I'm going to write down the freak identity, and you'll see that it is basically the Markov equation in disguise. So you cannot possibly have connectivity of the product replacement graph. What you can have, the best you can hope for, is that the level sets of the product replacement graph are such, I mean, that level sets of the product replacement graph given by the trace of the commutator are connected, and that's what they conjecture. And the results, our results that I'm about to state are valid in this more general setting, so we prove that conjecture, but let me tell you what the freaky identity is. So for k equals 2, you have the following identity with the freaky. This is equal to trace of A, trace of B, trace of AB, plus trace of the commutator, plus B. So here you can write this as x squared plus y squared plus z squared is equal to xyz plus k, where k is equal to trace of the commutator plus k. So the Markov equation is the case of the commutator equal to minus k. For 5 minutes. Okay, so let's take the results. And so I stated theorem 3. So let me state theorem 1 and 2. I think I'll stop that. Theorem 1 is, okay, so theorem 1, so I'm going to state the results just for Markov equation and prime moduli, the proof, and the results also hold for this more general equation, and for square-free moduli, the result, okay, theorem 1 is that Markov, so this has connected component, which we call a cage. So the complement, so if you look at the what is not in the giant connected component, this is very small. The second result is let me put it like so. Let E be the set of primes. For which on approximation. Fails. Then this set is also raised. So then the B, when we intersect it with zero, is also very small. And in fact, we prove this conjecture for all C, whichever. Times that P minus 1 isn't very smooth. I don't really have time to get into it, and I don't know if I have any time left to tell you about the proof. I think I should stop here. Apologize for going over time, and I'm happy to answer any questions. Maybe that's the best way to proceed. Yeah, thank you very much. So the sign, okay, maybe a giant. It's so the size of the graph. So the size of the graph is p squared. So the points which are not in the connected component, there are very few of them. It is in this sense that it is super. Well, it has a big, maybe giant is. Maybe I should call it huge. So there is a very big connected component.
Only one.
Only one. Well, there is another thing that. Okay. That's a very good. Let me. So there is a second part of the statement here. And all gamma orbits BP satisfy P of P is greater than log P to the 1/3. So we are looking at the connected component of 1, 1, 1, and it's huge. It should be everything. So these are not so. We do not yet have a complete proof of the strong approximation, let alone super strong approximation. But this results, and the generalization to square free moduli, are sufficient to prove theorem 3, which was that almost all Markov numbers are composite. And that's sort of that's one result which is, I guess, of independent interest, I would say, in the sense that it is very difficult to prove a statement of this nature for sparse sequences like 2 to the n plus b. That's,
so what is special about the Markov surface if you write a different equation? So we just take in some operations about.
Well, what is special? Okay, so. So there are several answers I can give. Via this formula, it appears in a great variety of contexts, in type Miller series, etc. So it, somehow it is indeed ubiquitous. So I cannot say the same about the Hurwitz equation, but the Markov equation somehow appears in very many very different areas. Now, as an algebraic surface, what is special about it is, first of all, you have many integral points, which as a risky dense on the surface. That is already quite special. And second, that you have this large group of automorphisms, which allows you to get all the integral points from the root solution. Okay, that's very special. But even the Hurwitz, maybe should emphasize is that even the Hurwitz surfaces, they do not, so when you look at the Hurwitz equation for greater than 4, greater or equal than 4, unlike Markov equation, it does not really appear as well. But there is something quite special about the Hurwitz surfaces, which I don't think we completely understand, because I have not seen, nor I think many other people have seen, the growth of integral points, which is of the firm log t to a power, which is most likely transcendental. So I think I think there is something happening there from the point of view of algebraic geometry, which I don't think we completely understand. If you think about this from the point of view of, say, I think it's for Butler-Manning conjecture, but that is for rational points. Right? These are integral points. Very different. Very different. So I think we do not. I told you briefly what I can tell you, but I think this is a question to which we do not yet have an answer.